Universal Studios Hollywood, I'm Sandy Newton. Next, I'll give you the inside word on Billy Crystal, Frank Sinatra, Jimmy Stewart, and Fred Dreyer.
From Universal Studios Hollywood, the heart of the entertainment world, Hollywood Insider. Hollywood Insider takes you behind the glitter and the glamour to give you the inside word on today's top stars.
On this week's Hollywood Insider, you'll find out if Hunter's Fred Dreyer is as tough in real life as he is on screen. Rock star Richard Marx will let you in on what it's like to become an overnight sex symbol. And Dan Frischman of Head of the Class will reveal what it's like to be immortalized in the public eye as a geek. Plus, we'll take a look back at the real Marilyn Monroe. Perhaps Jimmy Stewart is best known for his portrayal of a truth-seeking senator in Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. Well, it's hard to imagine the quiet Mr. Stewart harboring any ill will toward anyone, but that seems to be the reason that he turned down an offer to appear on the new ABC News magazine, Primetime Live. Our sources tell us that the well-known actor holds a grudge against the show's host, Sam Donaldson. You might recall that Donaldson was the White House correspondent for ABC during the Reagan administration. Stewart, who is known to hold very conservative political views, is a close friend of the former president. This loyalty came into play when the actor expressed his dislike for the way Donaldson covered Reagan during his term. When asked, Donaldson said he could not understand how the man who went to Washington as Mr. Smith and argued for the right and the just and the true would complain about how he questioned the president of the United States. Donaldson did admit, however, that he was honored that Stewart even paid attention to his work.
Well, they're small-time punks, but the only one without a record is Roberts.
Well, Fred Dreyer is not quite as mild-mannered as Jimmy Stewart, but Dreyer's tough guy image landed him his current role as Hunter. Dreyer's character is a square-jawed, tough-as-nails police detective. And as it turns out, Dreyer is just as tough in real life as he is on screen. Here's the inside story.
One, two, three.
When Hunter debuted in 1984, it was a ratings disaster. Now entering its sixth season, it's TV's top action show, and the star, Fred Dreyer, is a hit as TV's toughest cop. But Fred doesn't demand the luxuries usually associated with a star. He demands that everybody on the show work hard and do their best.
I don't ask to be picked up in a limousine. I don't ask for a bigger motorhome. All I ask for is the work to be better and everybody to be committed to that. On Saturday night, they see Fred Dreyer carry out what Hunter does. They don't see a production staff typing for an hour. They see me. And so if it's a failure, they remember my face.
Hey, Rick. Yeah. Check it out.
Dreyer got his no-nonsense approach from the 13 years he played pro football. As a defensive end for the New York Giants and later the L.A. Rams, Dreyer learned that strict self-discipline was the key to success.
Hard work, commitment, and sacrifice. And I do all those things. I know what all those things are about. I made the most out of what I am, I think, to myself, than I think most people have. You know, I mean, I was a limited football player. Came from that area into this position that I am here today, which could take me a long ways, you know, in my life. I could get out of it what I think will make me happy.
Intensely committed to his work, Dreyer demands the same level of commitment from his co-workers. This hard-nosed attitude has created some friction behind the scenes, especially last season when a new executive producer and associate producer were brought on board.
They eliminated all of our characters. They tried to introduce four characters onto our show that failed. They disrupted the chemistry and the harmony of the running operation of that show after 4 years of coming from 80th to 10th.
Well, those new producers won't be returning in the upcoming season. Instead, Fred Dreyer is going to co-executive produce Hunter. Once again, Dreyer has proven that he can tackle the opposition.
I came from 13 years of professional football. I realized what a grind that was. And I survived that. I survived being fired. I survived being having to, at 35, making a career change. I can do all, I can do that. That's not a push. I go by my wits, and I go by my common sense, and I go by a work ethic that I see in people that tells me they're willing to put as much into it as I am. And if they're not, just step left.
There's still more of Hollywood Insider coming up. Rising rock star Richard Marx will reveal what it's like to become an overnight sex symbol. And we'll get the inside word on how Dan Frischman, of Head of the Class, reacts to being immortalized as a geek. Stay with us. One actor who's impressed the critics lately is Billy Crystal. He's been getting rave reviews for his newest film, When Harry Met Sally.
You were a good friend of,
Amanda's.
But he gave a different kind of performance in New York last week. Baseball fans got a treat at Shea Stadium when Crystal joined fellow funny man Robin Williams at a recent Mets game. The two comedians were watching the New York team battle it out with the Cincinnati Reds when they were invited to cover a half inning on the air. The two were happy to pinch hit for the announcer and proved to be in top form. And they did so well, in fact, that instead of leaving after the first inning, they stayed for three. Billy Crystal said that his film got more promotion from that telecast than from all of his other promotional events put together. But Billy wasn't the only one to get something out of the deal. Robin Williams may play a teacher who also coaches soccer in Dead Poets Society, but he's never been much of a baseball fan. Well, that didn't stop him from making a lucky catch during the telecast, though, when a foul ball hit the back wall of the broadcast booth and Williams grabbed it. Well, some diehard baseball fans might be upset by Williams' beginner's luck, but the consensus among those lucky enough to catch the play-by-play is that Robin and Billy are a couple of all-stars.
I will be right here waiting for you.
Well, I don't know if you'd call it beginner's luck, but Richard Marx has a new hit record, and it's going all the way to the top. And he's learning to deal with the way that sudden fame changes your life. In his case, it turned him overnight into a rock and roll sex symbol. And that was a startling change for a man who wasn't exactly Mr. Popularity back in high school. Here's the inside story from Richard himself.
Oceans apart, day after day.
Richard Marx burst upon the rock scene 2 years ago with a debut album that spawned 4 top 5 hits. Now his second album is also a hit, with the latest single, Right Here Waiting, being played on almost every radio station in the country. Marx has the music world at his feet right now, but we found Richard to be more like the boy next door than the typical rock and roller.
When I was on tour, every night on the tour bus, the same stuff would go down. Wild stuff like gin. Gin rummy. Not gin the drink, but gin rummy. And, you know, videos of Arnold Schwarzenegger movies. And luckily, my entire band that I put together, they're all real straight. Nobody does any drugs, and nobody drinks. And I found personalities that really gel with mine. And it's we're really out there to work, you know. We're out there to stay sharp and to stay healthy and do the best shows we can possibly do.
Last year, Richard made Playgirl magazine's list of the 10 sexiest rockers. A somewhat cynical Marx believes that label has more to do with his new hunk image than sex appeal.
I mean, nobody looked twice at me in high school. You gotta understand, if you sing rock and roll and you're on stage and you're in a video, unless you look like the Hunchback of Notre Dame, girls are gonna think you're cute, you know?
What do you mean nobody looked twice at you in high school?
Every girl that I was really crazy about, they used to say the same thing to me. Every one of them would say, let's just be friends, huh? And I'd go. You know, I'd go home and cry my eyes out.
Everybody needs some freedom to survive.
But Marx isn't crying anymore. He recently married Cynthia Rhodes, a member of the rock band Animotion. Richard says his new wife has no problem dealing with his adoring female fans.
If you've seen Cynthia, she doesn't have anything to worry about, you know? plus, you got to understand, Cynthia was with me when I didn't have a job. Cynthia was with me when I was a struggling songwriter who couldn't get a record deal. And that holds a lot with me. That's something I always think about. My wife doesn't worry about it because I always go home to the same girl.
Cynthia may not worry, but Richard admits he sometimes does. Being a rock and roll heartthrob has had its unnerving moments.
The only thing that ever happened to me that was frightening was actually on stage. I got this much too close to the edge of the stage, and this girl grabbed my shoe or my pant leg and pulled, and I fell down, and then one girl became five, and then five became 20, and then 20 became 100, and they ripped my shirt completely to shreds, and I got up, and there was blood all over me from where they'd scratched me in. And I was sitting there laughing because it was so funny. It took about, I mean, it seems like a short amount of time, but it took about 3 full minutes for the security guards to get me away. And I got back in the dressing room, and I looked in the mirror, and I was bleeding, and it was pretty weird.
Rock and roll has transformed this down-to-earth 25-year-old into a larger-than-life sex symbol, but Richard Marx is confident he can continue to keep his feet on the ground.
There are moments when you, I'm sure you can get a little bit too big for your britches, but in general, I hate people like that. I know a lot of people who are really egomaniacs, and I hate them for it. So that's what helps me. And also the fact that my parents and my wife and my friends wouldn't let me get away with it in a second.
Well, Richard Marx just might have the girls fainting in the aisles, but he's got a long way to go to catch up to the lasting sex appeal of Old Blue Eyes. And Frank Sinatra has decided to put his money where his mouth is with a new line of Italian food products. The crooner will be spreading around the taste of his success when his line of pasta sauces hits the shelves in the spring of next year. The star modestly admits that he's received some pretty nice compliments on his cooking, so he decided to let the world in on his culinary prowess. Sinatra is not the first to lend his name to credible edibles. There are enough celebrity food products to stock a VIP aisle in the supermarket now. Some recent additions to the food chain at the stars include two products from the Newman's own line. Paul Newman has added lemonade and popcorn to his already long list of goodies. And those of you counting calories can look forward to an addition to Richard Simmons' line of low-cal cuisine. America's court jester of health hopes that buyers will gobble up his new frozen turkey burgers, which should hit the market in the near future. So if you're hungry for a taste of fame, there are plenty of celebrity chefs out there vying for your business.
You know, I remember when I was a kid, he was going to teach me to play catch, and he started explaining Newton's law of thermodynamics.
Well, Dan Frischman has become America's favorite nerd as Arvid on Head of the Class. Dan's found the stardom that he was seeking, but at the cost of being typecast as a geek. How does he feel about that image? Well, here's the inside story from Dan himself.
I'm going to have sex Friday night.
I see. You have that in writing?
In his role as Arvid the Nerd, Dan Frischman has emerged as one of the stars of the hit television comedy Head of the Class. That success has made his face recognizable to millions of Americans, but it also branded him with a geeky image.
I'm in the supermarket, and a girl comes out, very pretty girl. She says, "Hey, you're on television, aren't you?" I said, "Yes." I am. She says, "You're that geek." Yeah.
You know, usually it works for actors. But in this case, do you think it's a liability?
No, I don't think so. Because, you know what? Because people see me, and the first thing they go is, "I'm so happy you don't look like that." You know, you look a lot better in person than you do on television. You know, Mr. Moore, before I was in the IHP, I didn't have many friends. I mean, even the puppy I rescued from the pound left me for a more popular kid.
Frischman has gotten very comfortable with playing a geek. One reason is that he's had a lot of practice. In the numerous parts he's played on TV series and in the movies, he's usually been cast in the same type of role.
I seem to have always played kind of that nebbishy, I don't know if necessarily always a nerd, you know, the quintessential nerd, but always a guy who's a little down on his luck, a little awkward. For instance, on The Facts of Life, I played Carl Pizza Face Price. They did like an hour makeup job on me with tons of, you know, acne all over. I look like a goalie for a dart team, actually.
You'd think that being typecast in these sorts of roles would give Dan serious problems with his self-image, but the actor sees far more advantages than disadvantages to playing characters like Arvid.
Oh, I love it. You see, like, a guy like, say, Kirk Cameron, you know, very good actor, but he can't, you know, Arvid can get his head stuck in a volleyball net, you know. Kirk Cameron can't do that, so I get to have more fun.
Your practice brassiere?
I bought one for research.
Besides enjoying the comedic possibilities of his role, Frischman appreciates the feedback he gets from viewers. He's discovered that although Arvid's a nerd, people like him. In fact, they like him because he's a nerd.
Have you found that Arvid is real popular amongst the fans, that people root for him?
I think so. I think everybody, I think, has a bit of the nerd in them. Everybody's at one time or another felt awkward or insecure. So people like to relate to Arvid because they watch him and they say, well, I'm not that bad off.
But Arvid gets more than sympathy. His fan mail includes honest-to-goodness love letters.
And they say, oh, I love Arvid, and I have dreams about Arvid, and would you marry me?
Really? You get marriage proposals?
No, I'm asking you if you would marry me. No, I'm just kidding. I do get one, but they're usually from 12-year-old girls.
So being a nerd in high school is the kiss of death, but for Dan Frischman, being a nerd on television has been a blessing in a very uncool disguise.
There's still more of Hollywood Insider coming up. We'll delve behind the legend to try to discover the real Marilyn Monroe. Don't go away. Life is imitating art in Philadelphia as 12 people are temporarily banned from seeing the film Lethal Weapon 2.
Meeny.
Hey, Mom!
Hey, sorry, Adol.
A federal judge has forbidden a jury who is currently hearing an international money laundering case from seeing the film. He claims that the plot of the movie is too similar to the real-life drama being played out in the courtroom. The judge wants the jury to be able to render an unbiased decision, and he feels that the film might influence them. He defended his decision, saying the order was a small imposition upon the jurors to ensure a fair trial. A spokesman from Warner Brothers said that any similarities between the case and the film were purely coincidental. How long will this go on? Well, the trial is expected to continue into August. And judging by the big money the film is still making at the box office, those jurors should have plenty of time to catch the picture when the final verdict is in. Well, Marilyn Monroe had her share of courtroom drama in her life. Always in the public eye, her candle continues to burn brightly in the collective memory of the American public. But Monroe's legend has grown to such proportions that it's completely overshadowed the real person behind the myth. However, this new video documentary called Remembering Marilyn attempts to give you a glimpse of Marilyn as she really was. To see whether or not it succeeds, here are a few scenes from the tape.
You're wearing a high-head dress now. The last time I saw you were, is this a new Marilyn, a new style?
No, I'm the same person.
But it's a different suit.
America has an enduring obsession with Marilyn Monroe. We're fascinated not only by the dream girl on the screen, but by the nightmare that lurked beneath the glamour. Marilyn was a paradox. She was one of the most popular stars in the movies and one of the loneliest. This home video, called Remembering Marilyn, shed some light on the curious contradiction of her life.
I didn't like the world around me too much because it was kind of grim. But I loved playing. I loved playing with the children in the neighborhood, you know, running out and playing. We could imagine anything and pretend anything.
Quite a number of documentaries have been produced about Monroe. But this one stands out because the filmmakers have dug up a lot of rare footage not seen in other documentaries. This material includes interviews with Marilyn and some of the people who knew her best.
We had been asked to adopt her, and we really, really considered it because we loved her. She fitted in with our family beautifully. but finally we decided not to because we already had three daughters and we just really felt we had enough to take care of.
The majority of the interviews in Remembering Marilyn are with celebrities who knew Monroe. They include Robert Mitchum, Gloria Steinem, Susan Strasberg, and Robert Wagner.
I think she wanted people to care for her. For her as a person. For her, you know, not the Marilyn Monroe, not the double M, not the whole thing.
Remembering Marilyn also shows lots of rarely seen news and performance footage of Monroe. This includes her first appearance on television, her last public appearance, and some never-before-seen moments from the movie she was making when she died.
Jimmy, you know, far away in the South Sea Islands, when a man hurts himself and he doesn't want people to see, you know what he does?
What?
He has somebody else cry for him.
What's most intriguing about Remembering Marilyn is the insight it gives into Monroe's personality. The portrait drawn is of a lonely little orphan named Norma Jean, who completely changed her identity into the glamorous Marilyn Monroe. But she didn't find happiness with her fame and fortune because of the price she had to pay to get it, on the casting couch, in the role she had to play, and in the loss of privacy.
If I had had a child, I wouldn't want a child of mine to go through what I've been through. I like to stay here and now. Fame is fickle. It stirs up envy, fame. Who does she think she is, Marilyn Monroe?
Many people look at Marilyn Monroe and wonder how someone with beauty, fortune, and phenomenal popularity could be so deeply unhappy. Well, this home video helps shed some light on why the Hollywood dream can sometimes turn into a nightmare.
When we come back, we're going to tell you why the Catholic priests in Dublin, Ireland just can't let it be with the Beatles. Stay with us. Ireland has become one of the newest countries to take the rock world by storm. Artists like U2 and Sinead O'Connor are putting the Emerald Isle on the map. But there is a faction in the Irish capital who wants to see a change back to the old ways.
What makes a girl good? I don't know, you know. Oh, no, I was just helping you.
If you're planning a Catholic wedding and you're a Beatles fan, well, don't get married in Dublin. The Roman Catholic Archdiocese there has banned the song Let It Be from wedding ceremonies. A newly released church document deemed the song unsuitable as wedding music. This action was a response to the increased use of non-traditional music in weddings. When asked why the music was banned, a spokesman for the Archdiocese compared using secular music in church to singing hymns in a pub. He said if he sang a religious song in a bar, everyone would wonder what was wrong with him. We hope you'll join us next week on Hollywood Insider when Billy Crystal reveals some strange moments that took place behind the camera on his new film, When Harry Met Sally. Plus, Vanna White reflects on the price she's had to pay for her success. I'm Sandy Newton. Thanks for joining us on Hollywood Insider, the show with the inside line on what's happening in Hollywood. We'll see you next time.